Welcome to another round of the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast here at Georgia Public Broadcasting. Thanks for accessing us however you are doing so, large device or small. Very, very busy week last week. Very, very busy week coming up this week, especially here on GPB. We'll get into our game of the week and all the other news that is going on here coming up in just a little bit. But John here, Hannah there. And so now it's time to catch up with what is on your mind over the next little while here with the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast.
Yeah, jam-packed podcast as well. Here's what we got coming up on the show. We'll recap our Football Fridays in Georgia game of the week, North Cobb versus Walton. Take a look at what happened in region openers around the state. Preview Friday's matchup between Mill Creek and Buford and tell you what's to come in our brand new flag football coverage.
Yes.
Lot to get to today, John.
All right, so you want to start with what was before we go into what will be?
Yes, let's do that. So we had a Region 5 7A showdown between North Cobb at Walton. This one was at Raider Valley. Mm-hmm. The Warriors got their first region win of the season, 33-6, to go 4-2 on the year, 1-0 region play. They were leading 33-0 heading into the fourth quarter, John. That's when the running clock started.
Yep.
What a shocking ending to a game that was supposed to be super close in all of our eyes.
No doubt about it. And you end up with, you kept looking at the scoreboard, and every single chance that North Cobb had to be clinical, they were clinical. They took advantage of everything. They were stout defensively going up against Walton. And we'll hear from our Georgia Cotton Commission player of the game coming up in just a little bit, quarterback Nick Grimstead, who has taken over as a sophomore for Malachi Singleton. Hannah's had the chance to catch up with Malachi Singleton this year and find out what's going on with him as he heads to Arkansas. But this one was one of the top stunners of the week. A, that you got the upset, and B, the margin that it was, 33-6 the final, with that six being scored in the running clock in the fourth quarter. It was just a wow. It was a wow game on Friday night.
Grimstead was 6 of 8 passing, 186 yards, and 3 scores. Georgia Cotton Commission player of the game, like you said, John. Mm-hmm. And here's what he had to say after the big win.
It's very humbling. You know, it's a lot to learn real fast. But most of the part is humbling for, yeah.
Big game for the kid.
Yep, and a sophomore learning as quickly as he has been learning when it comes to this offense. And you've got all of these offensive weapons behind you. The running game has been absolutely stout for North Cobb, and then it's given Grimstead a bit of a cushion and a learning curve to get integrated into this offense as quickly as he has. And we also caught up with the North Cobb head coach Shane Queen afterward. Very emotional as always, because he's been through a lot this season and the team continues to strive.
Our kids believe in what we're doing at North Cobb. They know that we love them. And the adversity, this is because of all the adversity they've been through. And when our quarterback went down, nobody pouted and looked around. Nick Grimstead, jump in there and let's go. And that's what our kids, they love each other. They want to play for each other. And that's the difference in our program and some of the others.
And right after that, the whole team comes running over, basically dog-piling on.
Save the microphone. Save the audio and video equipment, please.
Oh, my gosh. You got trampled, John.
Well, actually, Shane got trampled. I was just trying to make sure I could get into the pile from the side to make sure that the microphone didn't end up, like, you know, to where you hear one of these, one of those moments. I just had to make sure that the mic stand and the microphone were going to stay as pristine as possible. They all went on top of each other, and it's great to see that kind of camaraderie for a team that has been through a lot, especially with one of their star players. But, yeah, to see that, just to make sure. I had to make sure the audio was going to be okay. All the TV equipment had to stay safe. That was the biggest thing for me. Forget me. If I get trampled, fine. Is the audio and
John.
Are the microphones okay, and are the cameras and lights okay? That's the number one priority. Forget John in this situation. It's the cameras and the lights, audio and video. John is like
John
ninth.
Comes away with scratches
John's
and bruises.
Ninth on the list when it comes to making sure that everything is fine.
One more thing about the game. We talked about the offense, but the defense, wow.
Yep. No doubt. And you know, you hold Walton, who is now 4-2, to just, they were hamstrung the entire night. And they were kept guessing on defense and on just you run out of words sometimes.
So well coached.
Yeah.
So well coached.
Yeah. When you have a game and an outing like you saw from North Cobb on both sides of the ball, Shane Queen said after the game, he says, "I've got the best defensive coordinator in the state of Georgia, no doubt about it." And they wanted the shutout so badly.
Hopefully they can hang on to him.
Yeah, and trying to do a Shane Queen impression really does hurt. You can only do that in very short bursts.
Take a sip of your lukewarm Mountain Dew that you've been sipping on for a week.
Yeah, I will in a bit. All right. So what else is on your dossier there?
Well, let's take a look around the rest of the state, and we'll kind of blow through my scoreboard here because I know you've got some games that you want to talk about.
Right.
So before Friday began, there was 43 unbeaten teams. It's not that way anymore. We'll start with Region 7 4A, where 7-0 Cedartown handed 6-1 now. Heritage Ringgold, its first loss of the season. Final score in that one, 42-0. And then in Region 1 AA, Worth County gave Fitzgerald its first loss of the season as well at Miller Field. That score was also 42-0. Then it was a big Region 3 4A opener for Burke County and Benedictine. The Cadets beat the Bears 28-3 on Thursday. At Wildcat Stadium in Region 4 4A, Trinity Christian beat Whitewater 27-23. And we saved one of the best for last. John, definitely need your take on this.
Yep.
The biggest rivalry game in Georgia, well, one of them. The Wintersville Classic was played at Martin Stadium this year between Valdosta and Lowndes. The Wildcats pulled it out 13-6. Vikings won it last year 21-0. What'd you think about that game?
Under 200 yards of total offense for Lowndes. And with everyone that was watching this game for me down in South Georgia, they're like, okay, touchdown, you know, touchdown Valdosta and a field goal Lowndes and a touchdown. They weren't able to match. Lowndes wasn't able to match what they were seeing offensively with Valdosta, but the defense has really been stout for Shelton Felton. They've kind of adapted his own philosophy when it comes to attitude and effort and those kinds of things. They really are Shelton Felton's defense, and it's been really intriguing for me to see them respond to the call against Florida teams and now in region play against Georgia teams. The Wintersville Classic out of the blocks in region play, tremendous work by Shelton Felton and their crew across the board.
Our web game?
Yes.
Kennesaw Mountain.
Yep.
Beat Osborne.
49-0. Yep. I know. But, you know, Kennesaw
Poor
Mountain.
Osborne. But happy for Kennesaw Mountain, but Osborne was, they were getting it going this year.
Yep. 49-0. It was 35-0 at the half. Kamen Prangley, 15-20 for 295 and 4. Caden Lee had 8 catches for 139 and a score. Dominant effort by Caleb Carmine. It was great to catch up with Caleb on the postgame show, by the way.
Yeah, he was great.
To see what it's like for him going back to his alma mater and bringing that program forward. Double-digit wins last year. I know the expectations are just as high this year for Kennesaw Mountain, but a dominant effort for them against Osborne. But still, great season so far for the Cardinals to this point.
So 6-0. Kennesaw Mountain is 1-0 region play. So they're sitting atop the Region 5 7A standings right with North Cobb, right?
Yep, and that matchup's coming up in short order. So you'll end up with I think it's 2 weeks from now.
October 21st.
Yep. So North Cobb has Wheeler this week. Kennesaw Mountain has Walton this week. Mm-hmm. So you have Kennesaw Mountain taking on Walton and you have Kennesaw Mountain taking on North Cobb. That round robin will determine your 1, your 2 and your 3.
Let's preview our game of the week because that coincides with our guests this week. It's a Region 8 7A showdown between two of the country's best teams. Mill Creek is ranked number 18 in the country, Buford number 7. This should be an incredible matchup between two powerhouses, some of the best in the country, John.
Mm-hmm.
Wolves trying to make Georgia high school history this season by winning a state championship in all classifications after reclassification brought them up to 7A. And Mill Creek trying to get to the state championships for the first time in a while. What are your thoughts on this matchup?
I mean, I know that we're all looking at the likes of Caleb Downs from Mill Creek, and we're looking at Justice Haynes for Buford, and I know that a lot of folks will have them in the spot shadow when it comes to your own personal TV open in your head, but it's more than just those two. It is the depth that you see from Buford on both sides of the ball. It is the effort that is there from Mill Creek trying to sit there and assert their personality when it comes to Gwinnett County football and being a top 20 program. And this is where we get to catch up with our guest, Mill Creek head coach Josh Lovelady, about this matchup and what it's been like to see Mill Creek evolve as a program.
Perfect. I'm so glad that you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. And so I'll go ahead and I'll cut the bridge here in case it happens. Okay. And then we'll go from there. All right. So here we go in 3. One coach down, one to go. Time to catch up with the other side of things. The nationally ranked, top 5 ranked nationally, Buford Wolves, and their head coach, Brian Apley.
Mill Creek head coach Josh Lovelady joins us now. And coach, I know you joined us on the postgame show a few weeks ago, but we haven't talked and you haven't been on the podcast in a while. So how are you?
Doing well, doing well. Just got off the practice field, trying to get ready for another big region matchup with Buford. So we got a lot of preparation to do for that team.
I've heard of those two schools, and last time I checked, you're both pretty good. When it comes to having two teams that are nationally ranked, you've got an afternoon practice because of holidays, and you're coming off of fall breaks and things like that. How difficult is it to keep focus, knowing all of this attention, like stuff that we're doing here, is kind of descending upon you for this week?
Well, it's not never easy because, like you said, you just hope to dive into the football part of it. But, you know, you've also earned this right for, with what the kids have done either this season or what the other opponent's done to make this a key matchup. And let's be honest, we've had Corky Cal, we've had other ranked teams we played. So it's kind of one of the things that we do the best we can, but also look at the flip side. It is another thing to add to your to-do list and to handle with logistic-wise, but it makes it more exciting as far as Friday night.
6-0, 1-0 with your first in region play, with your first region win over Central Gwinnett September 29th. You had a bye week this week, though. What sort of things were you focusing on to get ready for this huge top 20 matchup of the top two of the top teams in the country?
It's about us. You know, we did a summary as coaches and said, okay, this is what we feel like our guarded strengths and who we are after, you know, six games. And a lot of those guys, those teams exposed us on some things that are weaknesses or things that we need to address as well. So we made a kind of like a to-do list and say, let's do these things as far as offense, defense, special teams. Also kind of handled some situations that have not come up, you know, like a two-minute drill. We haven't had to do it. But it's, you know, you better have it ready to go, you know, if we need to pull it out or handling, taking a safety or whatever it may be. So most of it was about us, but I won't lie. We did start trickling in Tuesday and Wednesday some game plan for Buford.
How much tape do you and the staff watch for a game like this, knowing its import and its impact over a 10-game schedule and a region game and all those kinds of things and everything, all the bells and whistles that we're attaching to it? How much film do you actually go back and watch for a team that is as nationally ranked as you are?
Well, to be honest with you, it's every week. And it didn't matter who we were playing every week. Early in the year, it's tough when you play a Walton that had, you know, game one where you're kind of going back to the end of their year and say, okay, what do they do? But also then you have changing coordinators, things like that, to where now it's kind of a little easier in the season because you just look up the last 4 to 5 games and say, what is it they do well? What are some formations, alignments, things like that we need to address? Where can we attack them or feel like there's good matchups? But I'd say, you know, every game they played, we watched from game one on of theirs, and we've used the huddle app that allows us to collect data and see how many times in certain formations certain plays ran. And we just it's really almost like you hear in the NFL and college, it's data analysis and say, okay, you only have so much time at practice. Let's work on what is it they do well or what is it they do the most and their alignments. They may only do one or two things out of this formation well. That'll go down to the bottom of the list. So that's what our coaches do a great job of finding out those kind of this is what they like to do and run the numbers, and then we practice around it.
After all that data collection, what would you say your keys to the game are? What are some of the soft spots on the Buford team?
Wow. Coach Appleby on after you, so he wants to go ahead. Hannah's going to go ahead and lay this stuff out.
No, I'm not.
Put some bulletin board up there. I appreciate it.
I want to know what you're going after. I mean,
oh my goodness.
Y'all know what I'm saying.
Yeah, I hear you.
she's bulletin board material. That's what she's saying.
That's right.
What she's looking for.
Well, first of all, they're so well coached. Mm-hmm. Coach App and his staff does a great job over there, and you can tell year after year they put a quality product out, and that's a reflection of how he runs his program and the coaches and the players that are participating in that. I would say probably this year, you know, is their dynamic is – and offensively is probably one of the biggest things is they shift in motion a lot. I'm talking about moving people all over the place. And it creates some issues as far as lining up on defense to where you're not in the wrong place. And so you'll see if you go back and really look at the film, they move a lot of people around. And then you got, what, you know, three or four running backs back there that's that are can check out any play. It doesn't matter. So that's the biggest concern there as far as our defense is making sure we line up on gap sound. Offensively, you know, they have what, I don't know, y'all probably have the stats. 11 of them. 11 guys probably over there that I think every position has a scholarship offer. Mm-hmm. So that's there's not too many, you know, weak spots in the armor there that you can go attack. So, okay. You know, we kind of just going to be who we are as far as offensively and try to, you know, create some things on offense to, you know, stay who we are that got us this point. Don't, you know, scrap everything and say, let's just go run this and be because we got to throw up our hands and say, well, there's nothing there. So trusting our kids and what we do offensively to, you know, stretch people not only vertically with our, but also horizontally. I think we've got the best skill position we've ever had here at Mill Creek. Where we've kind of been liming you, we can still run the ball. We've got, you know, Cam Robinson is, you know, one of the top in the state as far as that, averaging, I don't know, 140 yards a game rushing, but also the guys on the perimeter that we can attack folks and bringing some guys over from the defense side of the ball has really helped us as well, playing two ways and spot playing. So I think special teams, it can be a toss-up. I think we've got some great special teams folks with Jacob Ulrich doing our punting and kicking where we can definitely flip the field on some things. But you also have a kid back there in Justice that's a kickoff returner that can check out at any moment too. So I think that's one of those coin flips on special teams as far as execution. So we just got it. Really, it's about, I think, as far as us being prepared to keep it a close game and take advantage of opportunities.
What's it been like for you to see this program, meaning the Mill Creek program, grow over time? Because it was, you know, it was Shannon and Andy and all of US Georgia guys, and I want to ask about that coming up in a little bit. But what's it been like for you to see this program grow to where it is right now when we're talking about programs, capital P, here in the state of Georgia?
Yeah. You know, it's ironic you said that because we did – Coach Hodges did a little – history lesson on Mill Creek because, you know, we're in year 19. So we went over and talked about the first 3 years, how they weren't done with our school. So we had to go to Norcross over in that area, bus kids over to do spring. We had to go the first 2 years where we had 90 freshmen and we only had back then, nobody transferred from Decatur North. They were two established programs when we opened up. So nobody transferred unless they either A, hadn't played the game of football, or B, they were not going to play there. So we had a lot of freshmen that we had to grow up, went 3-7 a couple of years, and then we ended up starting, you know, cracking the playoffs, jumping in region play and things like that. So we had to kind of talk to our kids and say, this is the foundation that we started solid, and y'all reaping rewards of it right now as far as not having to have rebuilding years, but just a reloading years and understand how. I think it's a correlation as far as our, also our culture, as far as how we treat our bottom half. You know what I'm talking about? Are we're getting reps for the Caleb Downs. Are we getting that sophomore reps and coaching him just as hard? That's going to be that dude in a year, if not 2 year, that's going to replace Caleb when she goes on to Alabama. That's where I think our staff does a tremendous job of taking that program and saying, hey, this isn't just a one-hit wonder for this year. We got to realize that this is a long-term investment in our program.
All right. Now, the West Georgia connection, I wanted to get into that here a little bit. There are a lot of you across the state, and our friends at the Georgia High School Football Daily came up with this massive, like, three-page printed list of all the coaches that came out of the University of West Georgia who are coaching here in the state. And Coach Lovelady and a lot of his friends, they're on this text chain. And it's been fun to see who's on the text chain, what these conversations are like. So, okay, so Coach, I need you to pull back the curtain a little bit. Who is on this text chain of yours? What do you guys talk about? And there are rules that are attached to this text chain too?
Yeah, I was finally added. I was
congratulations.
Yes, last year Dyer was just wearing me out, and John Small and a few of the other guys. He's at East Coweta, because it's all iPhone. You know, to have a group text and having all that stuff. So I had to get an iPhone to be part of the group, to be involved in there, and had a. So yeah, there's rules. The rules are you can only go so late. I think it's 10 o'clock in the, at night, and then in, you can't be in the middle of the night, someone watching a game and comment, or whatever it may be, and then you got in the mornings, you can't, you know, you got, it's kind of like a pause period. Because otherwise, when your phone goes off and you got, you know, 30, 40 guys on there.
We have a group text chain at GPB that I would like to be off of. Can I go ahead and put a request to get off of this? Saturday morning, we're rehashing the game that we all just lived. Ding, ding, ding. So this Saturday morning, we'll be talking about Mill Creek Buford all over again. I am up early, y'all.
Hannah's
I've got girls.
Trying to portal into your text chain.
I'd rather be into his than y'all's.
Well, you're right. When it starts going off, when you got, and it's like my wife will say, "What is going on with your phone?" And I have to silent notifications or stuff like that. It's like,
yes. Okay. Well, I've got one more question, Coach, and we talked about this on the post game show, but the podcast is a totally different audience, and I wanted to give your daughter one more shout out here, Ruby Reese. She's the freshman homecoming queen. That was a couple weeks ago. Tell us a little bit about that experience and just how proud you are as her father.
Tell you what, it was one of those moments, a special night. Holy cow. You know, I mean, I have a picture on my desk, and I think, John, you saw it. Her sitting in my lap that had the headphones on. It looks like it just engulfs her head when we first opened up. And Shan Jarvis always had a family-first, you know, a field house. And what I mean by that, some coaches are kind of like, hey, this is a working environment. You know, we need to, you know, it's professional. You know, kids are, you know, we don't need a bunch of kids running around here. You know, it's always been that way at Mill Creek. I mean, you'll reach down and say, what's on the floor? And it's going to be, you know, they'll have a Nerf gun fight in the summer. You know, and the whole field house will have Nerf guns all over it. We got to go pick them up. Or, you know, some kids scrape the knees, or you got to kick ball, go in the middle of practice, whatever it may be. So it's the family environment here at Mill Creek. But then we're a special ed hub here at Mill Creek High School, meaning we have some folks that have special classes that come here to Mill Creek from other districts. So our student council and our ladies, Megan Ivester, and some took the lead and said, you know, with that population is not, you know, they don't get to be in the regular classes. Let's have some representatives from those people, from those special ed pods. And so we did. And then they went in to vote. And I wouldn't have thought of anything, you know, about it. But then Jason Lane, our principal, said, in whenever she was named the ninth grade princess, which is by vote by the whole student body, it was just, gosh, it wasn't even close. And I mean,
wow.
I had a little saying to my at that moment, how special that was. And then she was just excited to be out there. She has her favorites of kids that and what's, and again, going back to being on the field house, you know, when a kid's in there injured and not in practice, the kids are running around here, they're doing rehab or whatever it is. Those, they get to go in the training room and go get a cup of ice, and they'll sit down and say, what's wrong with you? You know what I'm saying? And then they'll get to form relationships. And these kids, knowing that they have little ones around them, as we all know, high school kids can, you know, get a little, you know, with the language and everything else, it's also accountability piece where somebody's always watching them. So that was very special when she was named. I'll be honest with you, she's like her daddy, though. She's going like, she was ready. She kept asking my wife, Shannon, when do I get to have out of the dress? She's a t-shirt short kind of gal, and but she loved it. Dressed up, got to put, my folks were in town from Kansas, so my dad subbed for me to take pictures before, and then at halftime I went and walked her down, and then we had the pictures and everything else. And then this is kind of ironic. I don't know if I told John this is. Afterwards, I'm real big on, you know, being first class, doing the right thing, you know, for the, you know, the game has got, you know, the purity of the game. And afterwards, we beat Central, and afterwards, they were hooping and hollering and kind of gathered around, circled around. And I'm like, what's going on? And I was, to be honest with you, I was mad. I was going like, you know, dadgummit, are they celebrating? We don't do that. That's a locker room deal. You know, if you want to hoop and holler, you don't, because it could be perceived wrong. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, success celebration. And so I went around there, and I asked Beard, one of my coaches, says, what are they doing? I says, I'm fixing to light them up. And I go around the corner, and one of my coaches is like, Coach, they're all getting lined up for a picture with Reese. I went, you talk about flipping a switch. Went from anger to like, holy cow, how special is that? I mean, we just had a victory, first region victory, and all these kids are, you know, stacking around her, and she's in the middle. That was a moment. That was a moment that, you know, with all the stuff that's going on in the world, that's, you know, that's kind of negative or the scary for our kids. And you wonder, hey, what's our future like with our young people? You know, what are they making good decisions? that was one night that I'm like, you know what, we have a chance. It may be, you know, and with these group of kids, as far as taking 5 minutes and saying, hey, let's get some of my seniors, Hayden Clark and some of the other guys, got together and said, hey, when we get done with the handshake, let's all get around Reese and get a picture. And she has that picture framed up as we speak. So it was a special moment for not only for her, for our family, but also for those boys that realize that she's a Mill Creek Hawk through and through. That's for sure. And also goes back to sacrifices, as you know. I mean, y'all have to miss a lot on Friday nights for your families. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. Our family, and I can probably speak for a lot of folks on that text line or all the coaches around the state. Well, if you have a birthday on a Friday night, we're celebrating Saturday. Mm-hmm. It's not that we're not going to celebrate it, but we're going to go anniversary, anything, saying we're going to celebrate it. But if it's home game night, that's what you do. You know what I'm saying? We go to the football game and then we'll do that. So there's been sacrifices by her and all of the coaches' kids around the state that it's good for have that moment. That's for sure.
My twins' birthday is on championship, so we are doing it the following weekend.
There you go. Uh-huh. Exactly.
Well, she looked stunning, and I was going to give your Twitter a shout-out, so if people want to go see that picture, it's at Coach J Lovelady, and yes. People can go in and look at that picture with her in the center and the whole team. It's really cute.
Awesome. Thank you.
Well, Coach, thanks for hanging out with us and letting everybody know what's going on up there at Mill Creek. It's a big matchup. Two nationally ranked teams going at it on Football Fridays coming up this Friday. Thanks for hanging out with us here on the podcast and talking more than just the game with the two top 25s.
Well, thank you for having me, and go Hawks.
So it's going to be a great one again. Mill Creek versus Buford, Tom Ryden Stadium, Friday, 7:30 p.m.
But remember, the night starts before that.
Of course, Recruiting 2022 airs right before at 7 o'clock, and I was able to catch up with running back Justice Haynes from Buford this week.
You
guys want to check that out, and we'll air it during our halftime and post it on social media and stuff too. So he was a great interview, committed to Alabama. He had some things to say about his dad too, Veron Haynes.
Yes.
Great story there.
Yep. Let me guess. Was there a hobnail boot question?
Of course there was.
Yeah. Stepped on their face with a hobnail boot and broke their nose.
That's
what Buford's trying to do this week against Mill Creek, I'm sure.
I asked him, how many times have you been asked that
110 billion.
In your lifetime?
Yeah, 110 billion, I think, is the answer. So we got
We had some more games you wanted to take a look at from last week, John. What were the big storylines?
Yeah, I mean, for me, you talked about Wintersville. You talked about Fitzgerald's big win against Worth County. The one for me, Appling. When was the last time you heard of a team playing twice in 5 days?
What?
Yeah, get this. The game, remember the podcast last week?
Mm-hmm.
Appling and Pierce?
Yes.
They got pushed because of Hurricane
Ian.
Yes,
we previewed the game endlessly, and it didn't happen.
Yeah, so they pushed it to Monday.
Okay.
And so they play it on Monday. Pierce County loses to Appling 28-17. John Kuhn was down there for me, and he's like, yeah, the Appling County's offensive line is just huge, and they're just pushing everyone around. And so that's something to keep an eye on with Appling County. So they play on Monday. Then they play on Friday. So basically it's like Tuesday's recovery, Wednesday's maybe a little bit of practice, Thursday's your walkthrough, and then you go and play Toombs County, and you win 34-21. So Appling County had 2 wins in 5 days last week.
Wow.
So that's pretty funny. So,
do they at least get a bye week?
No, they're at Windsor Forest, by the way, this week.
Tough.
So, yeah, they play Windsor Forest. So it'll be 3 games in 12 days for Appling County to get back online.
And what if they get all 3 wins? That'd be pretty epic.
Yep. So that's just some of the highlights for me this week.
Cool. Well, we have another game to look forward to. It's our web game, Region 2 5A, Jones County versus Dutchtown in Hampton, Georgia. The Bulldogs are 6-0, 2-0 in region play, looking to maintain that undefeated schedule. And Jones County, 4-3, 2-1 in region play. What are your thoughts on that one, John?
Offense versus defense. And literally, that is literally what you're staring at when you look at the Dutchtown Bulldogs and head coach Nikita Battle. It is defense, 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 and did I mention defense? They suffocate you on defense and have done a tremendous job doing that. Jones County, with their very talented junior pitch and catch combo, Mike Chastain, he wants to light up the scoreboard all night long. So it's going to be contrast in styles and which one of you wins out. Literally, it's the defense of Dutchtown, the offense of Jones County. Which one of you is going to sit there and get the Duke? And it will be the interesting clash of styles on the web game. By the way, Jones County, home of the best barbecue on the planet, by the way.
Is there an example?
Yeah, Old Clinton. It's right there on the right there on the Gray Highway as you're heading into Gray itself.
Okay.
On the way to Jones County High School, Old Clinton Barbecue, best barbecue in the state.
What's your order?
For me, it was straight up barbecue sandwich.
Okay.
Double mac and cheese. And I left with a big tub of their vinegar-based barbecue sauce.
Oh, that's the best. That's
And also, like 3 extra pounds of their pulled pork.
Oh, my gosh. Vinegar-based sauce. Uh-huh. Could drink it.
So there you go.
Okay, most importantly.
Yes.
We're getting
Other
to the end
the
of
food?
The food? Yes, more important than the food.
Okay.
Flag football is starting this week. I am so excited. So we have our kickoff tournament called the Clash of Champions.
Clash of Champions.
Which is, thank you, John, which will be hosted this Thursday, October 13th by West Forsyth. Mm-hmm. And we've got a loaded lineup at 6 p.m. It's Southeast Bullock versus Hillgrove, 7 p.m. Archer versus Portal, 8 p.m. West Forsyth versus Marietta. And these are state champions, runner-up, semifinalists.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these are really good. Some of the best flag football teams in the state. This is going to be so fun, and I'm so excited to showcase these girls and what they can do on the football field.
And I mean, these are athletes that get scholarships because of
and
flag
job
football
offers now.
Yeah, and so you're getting this and being able to. This is our third year being able to show it on Georgia Public Broadcasting, and it's going to be on our streaming platforms here with Clash of Champions. As kind of a build-up to the championships at Georgia State, where we get to showcase the best there as well. Remember, Dodge beat Lithia Springs last year in the 5A, 6A title game. So you're dealing with the single-to-quad champ, the single-to-quad runner-up, 7A state champ, 7A semifinalist, the 2020 6A, 7A champ in West Forsyth, and the 7A runner-up in Marietta. And this one's going to be fun. We've had folks reach out to us on social media when we would show the championships and sit there and go, this is the addiction that I didn't know that I had until I started watching. And it has been, the downloads on YouTube are tremendous. It's some of our most downloaded games across the board at GPB Sports. And to be able to have this as kind of our kickoff for the flag football season, very, very cool to be up there at West Forsyth.
Yeah, and I heard the games are being rewatched like crazy right now on YouTube to get ready for this. So then after this Thursday, we will have a flag football stream every single Thursday. Follow us at GPB Sports for the announcements on which games we will be at. Okay, before we go today, we got to do our quick staff whip around. Laster lost to Roswell 58-0.
You see
Central
how she
Macon
blows through
lost
that?
Lost to Ace Charter 32-6. Parkview is off. They play Archer this week. Okay, then the winners. What are the winners, John?
Well, Commander Sandy's Decatur beat Arabia Mountain 23-8. So they're not. See how she blows through the losers in the week?
I did notice that went very.
Especially that Lassiter score.
We're out of time,
that
John.
That Lassiter score just kind of. Yeah. It was.
What did he say last week? He was going to take care of business. I guess Roswell did.
Yeah, exactly.
I was trying not to talk about this.
Yeah, see, Coach Pruitt, he held himself to his word in the postgame show on Football Fridays.
He said, quote,
yeah.
We'll take care of them for you.
We'll take care of them for you. Yeah, how's that for a double-sided quote? We know what he meant now. But yeah, Central Macon's Chargers lose to Ace Charter. Ace Charter's been putting up some really strong numbers, Coach Hatcher and that offense. But Central Macon loses. Jake the Snake's Parkview is off. Parkview and Archer, that's a big Gwinnett County battle. All right, so now Decatur wins. They go to 3-4. Lakeside beat Drew. We're now 5-2, but we play a non-region schedule. And once again, Ambassador Jeremy's Darlington team. Ambassador
Back
Jeremy's Darlington.
Got it.
Beat Chattooga 48-21.
Jeremy's beating us
7-0.
7-0.
3-0 in region. So that's strong there in single A for Ambassador Jeremy to get he's out there.
Might be the only 7-0 team in Georgia.
No.
I'm just joking.
I think Early County's 7-0. See, now you're going to have me look it up Early County quickly.
What teams are 7-0? I need all of them.
Well, we got a lot of 6-0s. Darlington's at 7-0. Elbert and Rabun, and that's another big matchup coming up this week. Elbert and Rabun, both 7-0. Early County 7-0. So you got a handful of folks that are 7-0 that are chasing after. We still have a lot of 6-0s, but yeah, 7-0 trying to get to their bye weeks late in the year so they can rest up for season 3.
We'll give you all the best games to watch on Countdown to Kickoff on Thursday. Join us. On CTK, GPB Sports Facebook Live, noon, Thursday.
Yes, book them, Dano. Aloha. Mm-hmm.
What you writing about this week on your blog?
You're still undefeated. some of the more undefeated folks that are still hanging in there.
How many are there now?
See, now you want me to do math. You don't want that. I'd be here forever.
TBD. Yes. Well, we'll let you know on Countdown.
There you go. So it sounds like a column, and it sounds like a show.
That sounds like a show to me.
All right, so let's see. For everybody here, so who's behind the glass? Let's see. For Hannah, who's right there. Let's see. It's Jake the Snake, Ambassador Jeremy, Commander Sandy, King James, and that's
it.
I think that's everybody, and you. So that's you. And
you're
so,
welcome.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome.
I like how the thank yous just work their way backwards. It's like, you're welcome.
Yeah. You're welcome for another great show. You're welcome.
Yes.
Because I did this.
Yes. You're welcome because I did this. We're gonna put that on the board in the office.
Let's make sure.
It's another quote from Hannah that goes in the office. So for all of us here at GPB, I think it's time to go because Hannah needs some caffeine and I need some lunch. So for everybody here at GPB, play safe, everybody. Enjoy your games. We'll see you next week.